Here I am. I'm about 5 miles inland from the San Andreas Fault. Not a lot of stuff is blooming here. It's mid-March. It rained all night last night. I slept down just to the left of the cameras looking right there. You can see the dogs are still waiting down there because I don't want them coming up here getting covered in ticks and trampling flowers and what the shit. Not much is going off except some primula. The artist formerly known as Dodecatheon. You can see some right there, that pink eye. Shooting star is the common name. Whatever. Anyway, oh, look at this. Here's a nice Lomatium. Apiaceae, the carrot family. These are, I believe these are Clarkias. Beautiful four-petaled onograd. Evening primrose waiting to go off. And of course, I'm standing beneath a beautiful, you know, it's hard to tell. I'm going to say that's probably a valley oak, Quercus lobata. But look at this. I believe this is a Wyethia. Kick me in the balls if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure it's a Wyethia. I haven't really familiarized myself with this family since they've been dormant, since I've really taken the head dive into Asteraceae. But I do want to mention, look at this involucre. Okay, this is the involucre. All right, it's basically a series of bracts, the series of roofing shingles that surround the outer cup of a composite flower. And this is a phyllary. So you have an involucre which surrounds the capitulum, all right? Okay, you catching this, jackass? And then you get the bracts, those roofing shingle bracts, those are the phyllaries. Capitulum, involucre, phyllaries. And on this one, this is, I mean, this is really a good flower because most composite flowers are too tiny, okay, to really look at, you know? But this is about the size of a golf ball. Excuse the reference, I kind of hate golf. And it's really, it's enlarged. So, you know, you're getting kind of a double tree times magnification. Okay, and this is very glandular. It's very glandular. These have a perennial taproot, these Wyetheas. And they're really easy to confuse with Balsamoriza, which you get up at higher elevations. So Balsamoriza and Wyethia both have perennial taproots. They look a fucking lot alike. They're really hard to differentiate. But pretty sure this is a Wyethia. Haven't checked out what species yet. Got the Jepson down there in the trunk. But look at this. You get a really nice close-up view at everything going on. See, this what you think is a flower is actually composed of about, I don't know, what does it look like? 50 flowers, maybe? You got 50, okay? And see, it's a floret. See, so an individual flower on a aster capitula, trembling so much, it seems like I got Parkinson's or DTs, but I don't drink. So let's hope it's not Parkinson's. Oh, anyway, you got this tiny little floret in there. You got five fused petals. The petals are fused together, all right? And then this is a very excellent excellent portrayal of what's called secondary pollen presentation, because you got some florets, at least one floret is in every stage of maturity. Now remember, aster flowers have a centripetal maturity. They have what's called centripetal maturity, so they mature from the outside in. Louis, what are you doing? I said don't come up here. What you doing? There's no pepperoni for you. That's it. You know what? You're getting... Hey. Okay, anyways, back to what I was saying. Sorry for the digressions, you know. They come up, they don't listen. You know, it's ever since I gave them those chorizo tacos down by El Socorro, you know, a month ago, they're spoiled. They just think they can do whatever they want, walk all over me. Anyway, here's... So you got these florets, right? As I said, they have centripetal maturation. So the flowers mature from the outside in, the individual florets on an aster head. Now, some aster heads are weird. They might only have four or five florets per capitula. This Wyethia has about 50. You know, you look at the genus Stevia. Yes, it's not just the yuppie sweetener. I actually like Stevia. The Stevia flowers have four or five florets per capitula. This one has 50, okay? Some asters only have one floret per capitula. Those are real fucking weird, okay? I don't know how that works. It's pretty interesting. Anyway, so you got these florets maturing from the outside in, okay? When they're in the female phase, they're, see how this one right here? This is peeled back like that, like a Y? That's in the female phase. That's receiving pollen, okay? These ones right here that are still just look like a little twig poking out, they haven't opened up into that Y shape yet, they're in the male phase, all right? And this is what's really hard to wrap your head around. Mostly when you see, appendages popping out of a flower, any flower, they're mostly stamens. They're mostly the male parts. Okay, stamen has pollen anther filament, right? This is with asters, it's the opposite. The stamens always stay inside. The anthers are fused together. Okay, the stamen is the full part of the full male flower. Okay, consisting of polyanther and filament. The anthers are always fused together on asters, and they're in a fused column down there. So how does an aster flower produce that, get that pollen out there to the world? Well, it takes the style, the female part, it's called secondary pollen presentation. It takes that style and it pokes out of the anther. And as that style starts to emerge from the anther, you know, kind of like, I'm not going to use that reference, it's kind of gross. Anyway, as the style starts to pop out of that fused anther column, it brushes some of the pollen off the insides. And when it does that, it exposes the pollen to pollinators. Jesus, I can't catch a break. You know, I got the dogs not listening to me. Camera's running out of storage space because I talk too much and rant. This is taking too long. Anyway, so right here, as I was saying, that female style comes out of the fused anther column, all right? And the pollen's on the inside of that fused anther column, which completely surrounds the style, the female part. And as that style comes out, it scrapes some pollen off the fused anther column and exposes it to pollinators. Like you could see the innermost ring of mature flowers doing. Now where it's dark right there, those just haven't matured yet. But the innermost ring is in the male phase. They're, those styles are exposing pollen to pollinators. And then of course when they're done, they're in the female phase, like those on the outside. They've got those little curly Q Ys right there. Okay? And so that's how aster flowers mature, and it's pretty fascinating. It's good because there's always something going on for pollinators. All right? Not always, but during a flowering season, there's always going to be something going on for pollinators. There's always going to be a floret producing nectar and pollen, and it works. It works. And then, of course, when it's mature, this whole seed head, you know, gets about, I don't know, what is it, 50, 60 seeds on it? Now, on some of the asters, the either the marginal florets are sterile or unisexual, or the inner disc ones are sterile. Like on Silphiums, I think the inner florets don't produce seed, you know? They're not, they don't got a female phase. Maybe they just produce pollen, whatever. Anyway, now Silphium's a genus in the Midwest that don't really apply here. But basically, you know, there's always something going on for pollinators. The flower, in essentially, this entire capitula ends up lasting a long time. And then, of course, you know, come July or August, this whole thing dies back because it's the dry season here in California. Remember, we're not getting rain anymore in July and August. And it dies back to the perennial taproot, which is probably, you know, massive, and it waits again for the rains of next year. But meanwhile, all that seed disperses, you get new plants.